to express my sincerest gratitude to all parliamentarians and provincial assembly members for their trust and confidence in electing me for a second time as the President of the Islamic Republic of Pakistan. I am humbled by this opportunity to bestowed upon me by the grace of Almighty Allah. Mr. Speaker, let me begin this parliamentary year by sharing briefly my vision for future, because much of it's based on choices we make in my particular role in the past too. I have made important choices that made history. When I chose to give away my own powers as president to the Parliament of Pakistan, I expect you as parliamentarians to use those powers with the wisdom and maturity our country merits and needs. I see my own role today as a unifying symbol of a joint, robust federation where all people and provinces should be treated in equal before law. At the same time, in my considered view, it is time to turn a new page. If we see today as a new beginning, which it is, that we can build on our strength by investing in our people, by focusing on public needs, by harnessing our relation of our resources to create pathways to inclusive growth. I also feel that we have little time to waste. The country needs us to move on from the polarization so common now to contemporary politics. This joint house must play a leading role in rebuilding public confidence in the parliamentary process and establish a foundation for the uninterrupted sustainable development of our nation. Let us not confuse constructive disagreement and healthy noises of a growing democracy with a pursuit of zero-sum thinking. The country needs us to take pause and reflect on what we prioritize in our goals, our narratives, and our agendas. I believe we can resist the political atmosphere to reflect more light than heat if we really want to. But it will need all of us to step back and decide what matters the most. I mean all of us. At the end of the day, it is up to all of us to turn challenges into opportunities, because that is what robust nations do. I have always drawn inspiration, guidance from great leaders such as Qaid Azam Muhammad Ali Jinnah, Shahid Zulfiqar Ali Bhutto, Shahid Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto, who spend their lives being advocates for democracy, tolerance, and social justice. I firmly believe that by embracing the vision of these leaders, we can effectively tackle our challenges and foster an atmosphere of mutual respect and political reconciliation. The challenges we face are not impossible to overcome. They just require a fundamental of meaningful dialogues, parliamentary consensus, and a timeline implementation of rigorous reforms aimed at addressing underlying issues, both old and new, confronting us. I strongly believe that in order to align our country with the 21st century, it is imperative that we move forward on reforms to promote good governance for the provision of optimal social entitlement to our citizens. Let's begin with a vision that strives to leave no one behind, for this thought to move beyond an idea. The political leadership gathering in this House must prioritize the specific needs for marginalized communities and underdeveloped areas. By focusing on the needs of these regions, we can bridge the gap between them and the more developed areas of the country, moving the needle towards an inclusive growth model that emphasizes equality of opportunities. While there are many economic reforms the government will drive in pursuing jobs, reducing inflation, and expanding the tax net, I want to underscore the importance of promoting positive working relationship and effective coordination within our constitutional framework between the federal government and the provinces. This is an absolute essential for promoting an inclusive national development agenda. Ruling out policies that execute tangible actions on the ground. I firmly believe that by driving seamless collaborations as fostering institutional coordination with intentions and regularity, we can harness full potentials of our federal system to deliver positive change for benefit for people of Pakistan. Mr. Speaker, honorable members of the Parliament, Pakistan needs all hands on deck to revitalize its economy. Without shedding all caution to the winds, our primary objective should be to attract foreign direct investment. I therefore urge the government to intensify its efforts in implementing comprehensive ease of doing business reforms and simplifying the existing forest of the regulations to provide an enabling an environment for both foreign and domestic investors. I commend the establishment of the Special Investment Facility Council aimed at attracting and facilitating investment in the key sectors, which is a step forward in the right direction. At the same time, we must accelerate our endeavors to diversify export, enhance the competitiveness of our products in global markets, introduce value addition, and venture into new markets similarly. The huge untapped potential in the agriculture, marine life, information technology, textile sector should be exploited to earn foreign exchange. Any global or national stocktake will tell us that the world is changing fast under our feet. Pakistan has been sincerely devastated by different impacts of climate change, especially in the shape of a catastrophic flood in the 2022. We urgently need to invest in climate-friendly, climate-resilient infrastructure to mitigate the rapidly compounding risk of climate change. At the same time, we need to ensure the clean energy technology from the core component of our national energy mix, as they would not only create opportunities for green economic growth, but would also make energy more affordable for our people. Mr. Speaker, the provision of primary and secondary education is a fundamental right, and its current state should keep all governments awake at night. We must acknowledge the fact that in Pakistan there's a massive number of children who are out of school, and given our growing population, the number is growing faster than the facilities we have been providing. I therefore urge all provincial governments to bring focus and energy on transformative reforms on education sector, not just on improving access to primary secondary education for all children, but for ensuring quality as well. Mr. Speaker, respected parliamentarians, I am sure all agree that our health sector is in urgent need of rebuilding and scaled up expansion. Regular investments in the primary and secondary health infrastructure as well as human resources are needed to ensure that every citizen has access to quality of healthcare services and that no citizen lacks medical care. Mr. Speaker, a combination of factors has come together to create what I see as a crisis of income and food insecurity for many of our people. I am pointing, of course, to the large number of our population that has been slipping into poverty, either through climate impacts on their incomes and assets or sheer cost of living pressure on the families. It is our responsibility to ensure that they move out of extreme vulnerability within the ability to access opportunities for jobs and resources to reinvest in farms, livestock and small businesses. I am proud to say that I come from a political background that has rich legacy of empowering and protecting all those at the bottom of the social pyramid, including women. Shahid Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto was a champion of women's rights and always went on extra mile in advancing women's causes, just as she sought entitlement of economically and socially vulnerable groups of Pakistan. I am very proud of the fact the Benazir Income Support Program has been providing a lifeline to millions of vulnerable women across the country, offering them financial assistance and social protection, while giving many women the incentives and seed capital to start up small businesses. I'm glad that the number of the beneficiaries of the poverty alleviation program has risen to over 9 million, but we need to bring more underprivileged women into the social safety net. I am hopeful that the new government will actively work to reduce social and economic fragility while aggressively promoting girls' education and health, including programs to reduce maternal mortality and enhance mother and child income. Mr. Speaker, you are aware the menace of terrorism is again rearing its ugly head and is threatening our nation's security as well as regional peace and prosperity. Pakistan believes that terrorism is a shared concern that requires collective efforts. We expect neighboring countries to take strong notice of terrorist groups who are involved in launching attacks against our security forces and people. Today, I reaffirm the nation's resolve to eliminate terrorist elements. My late wife the twice elected Prime Minister of Pakistan, Mohtarma Benazir Bhutto Shaheed, gave her life standing up to terrorists, so you will never find me wanting in building the unity and the momentum behind such an effort. We are proud of our armed forces, law enforcement agencies who have rendered immense sacrifice and played a heroic role in the fight against terrorism, defense of our national frontiers. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank our friendly countries, particularly Saudi Arabia, UAE, China, Turkey, and Qatar, who have always supported Pakistan in difficult times. It is important also to recognize the US, EU, and UK have all been established trade partners with a history of cooperation in many sectors, which we hope will grow further. I extend my heartfelt gratitude to China for its unwavering support to Pakistan in various fields and enduring strategic all-weather friendship between Pakistan and China is a cornerstone of stability in the region. We remain steadfast in our commitment to collaborate with China to advance our shared goals and fostering regional peace, promoting connectivity, ensuring prosperity, and maintaining stability, which includes completion of the China-Pakistan Economic Corridor. We will not allow hostile elements to jeopardize this vital project or undermine the strong bond between our two nations. We will take all necessary measures to ensure the security of our Chinese brethren and sisters. Before I conclude, I must remind the world of the unsung sacrifices of our Kashmiri brethren. Their ongoing struggle for the freedom of Indian illegal occupied Jammu and Kashmir, the revocation of Article 370 and 35A is part of India's strategy to reduce Kashmiris Muslims to a minority in our own homeland. Pakistan rejects the one-sided India action and calls upon India to reverse all illegal measures taken on or after 5th of August 2019. I assure our Kashmiri brothers and sisters that Pakistan will continue to provide moral, political, diplomatic support to the people of occupied Kashmir until they get the right to self-determination. Pakistan believes that the key to durable peace in South Asia is the resolution of dispute in accordance with the United Nations Security Council resolution. Similarly, we are deeply concerned over the tidal wave of indiscriminate killings of innocent Palestinians, the large-scale genocide committed by the Israeli forces. Pakistan strongly condemns the brutality and immunity of occupation forces and remains steadfast in principled support for the establishment of an independent and viable state of Palestine based on the pre-96 borders with Al-Qudus al-Sharif as its capital. Mr. Speaker, Honorable Parliamentarians, I have complete faith in the capability of our political leadership, public institutions, civil society, and youth to successfully overcome the multiple challenges facing our nation today. This is based on my unshakable belief in the citizens of people, knowing that whenever we unite to make common cause, we deliver on our promises. Today too, I believe we can pull together to draw on our moral political capital in steering our country out of its complex but not impossible social, climate and economic challenges. Once again, let me entreat you all to think of this great country as your driving motivation for service in this House of Parliament. Let us demonstrate a spirit and words, a renowned political ethos, a collaboration and census building as the guiding principle to lay the groundwork for a more prosperous Pakistan. I'm certain that together, in a fresh start, we can start a course towards a strong, prosperous Pakistan. May Allah be our guide and support this journey. Ameen. Pakistan, find the bar.